So I'm Jon Philips from Silverback Management. Been a music company since 1998. And I was originally an A&R executive at Gasoline Alley. And Gasoline Alley had been an independent sort of co-venture label with MCA Records in the 90s. And in 1993, I met Brad and Sublime and had ended up signing them to the label as an A&R person for Gasoline Alley. They put out a couple of records on Skunk Records on their own, and I found out about the band, started going and seeing some shows. It was just one of those things that the music was so infectious, it drew me to the band, and we created a scenario for them to record and release their third record, their self-titled Sublime album. By the third record, I mean, Miguel was there, sort of the glue that was sticking everything together, and as a production, you know, producer slash consultant to the other producers and general, you know, coordinator on that level. So Miguel was involved. The band was Brad, Eric, and Bud at that point. That was the face of Sublime. That's who was playing live in the band. In the studio, they shared a little bit more of a collective attitude. Obviously, Field Marshal, both as a DJ who does a lot of the scratching, a lot of the, you know, cuts on the self-titled record, also plays drums, Field Marshal Goodman. And obviously, you know, he was a drummer who was in Sublime and then, you know, wasn't in Sublime after they've traded a few drummers. But in this instance, you know, Marshall was brought in to do a series of songs, and he also produced the original track for Doin Time.
Doin Time, straight hip hop. There's nothing, no question about it. It sounds reggae because I chose that sample for Sublime because of that. The bass line is reggae, but it's a Herbie Man rendition of Summertime, and the way Herbie Man played it, it just had that nice vibe, and I drew from that and just played the same bass line that was there with the SH-101 and then threw Cold Blood Thriller drums on it with the 16th note kind of reggae feel. So we really merged three different styles, reggae, punk, and hip hop together, and threw it out there. We had no plans. We were just guys writing music together. Summertime.
You see this crazy lineage of music and American sort of history in a sense. For me, it's like folk music when it makes its way down through, you know, the oral traditions and pass on the allusions to these other works, you know, that came before it. And with Doin Time, I think it's a pinnacle of Sublime's recording history because it encompasses so many different forms of music. And then, like I said, it's Gershwin's Summertime, instrumentally as interpreted by Herbie Mann, which Marshall samples off the vinyl from Live at the Village Vanguard, creates the track, throws in a Beastie Boys sample, throws in, you know, his breakbeat flavor and drums, and gives it to Brad, and Brad writes, you know, this incredible lyrical counterpart and style to it. But with Doin Time, there's a really cool historical, like, story behind how that song actually made the record. It was one of those situations where the band, in, you know, true Sublime style, I mean, the music that they were making, you can tell from 40 Ounces to Freedom and Robin the Hood before it, sampling and interpolations were a big part of their craft. And like a lot of great literature writers will allude or even take a passage from somebody that came before them, Brad did that a lot with music, and Sublime's music became an amalgamation of a lot of these things that came before it. With Doin Time, again, it was like they weren't thinking commercially, like, oh, how are we going to clear this sample, and how are we going to, like, you know, clear the interpolation because I took some of Gershwin's lyrics and put my own on top of it. Legally, you're not supposed to do that. It becomes a fundamental change of lyrical content from a master work. So with Doin Time, we were so excited about the outcome of that song and the, you know, potential that it had realized. I mean, to me, it was definitely one of my favorites. Sublime, it turned the corner for them, I think, from a progressive angle. And Brad knew it as well. And unfortunately, you know, a couple of weeks before Brad had passed away, and this is before the self-titled record comes out, the Gershwin Estate, when approached by Universal Publishing, basically denied the usage. And the song was already composed, produced, mixed, mastered, done, and was, you know, we were anticipating was going to become a cornerstone of this particular album. And I had to call Brad and tell him, hey man, you know, just got word from the label that they don't know if they can clear Doin Time. So we were both obviously extremely disappointed and, you know, crushed that, hey, I don't know if it's going to make the record or not, you know. And a couple of weeks later, Bradley had passed away. And, you know, the record sequence and the, you know, final sort of like output of what that record was going to be wasn't decided upon. And Monkey Wrench with Doin Time is the Gershwin Estate says, we're not going to allow you to put that out. So start going through the, you know, channels of how do we actually try to not allow that to happen and make it so we can have this music see the light of day. It's worthy of it. And to me, it was historical. And by God's gift, it happens that the Gershwin Estate of Ira and Leonore Gershwin happens to be in the same office building as the record label that I'm working for. So I'm like, well, I might as well just, you know, knock on their door and see what their connections to the clearance could be. And so, yeah, I just went up, you know, a floor above where my office was for, you know, 3 years and knocked on the door and said, hey, you know, I'm from the record label downstairs and we've got a situation that perhaps you could help us with if you are actually, you know, the Gershwin Estate. And they introduced me to a you know, person who was working there that was in the department responsible for clearing the music and making those decisions, and happened to be a guy that, you know, I had rode up in the elevator with casually, you know, quite a few times, said hello, never really got beyond that. But hey, I'm sitting here face to face with a guy, it's like, oh hey, I know you from, you know, guy turns out to be from my hometown up in the Bay Area, and shared a lot of sort of similarities. So I proceeded to explain to him that, hey, you know, this is one of those pieces of music where it's something that takes the history of what the great composer Gershwin did, who they were representing, and it was sort of a passing on of, you know, that through jazz and hip-hop into this sort of California reggae and new pop music that was making its way and permeating through the new sort of, you know, subculture and pop culture, and got them to understand it. They actually had a few requests and changes that they wanted to see happen with the song before it actually was commercially released. So originally the song is called Doin Time, and it's actually still called Doin Time, and some people might wonder why. Brad's original lyric was Doin Time and the living's easy, and the song sort of is talking about how he relates this relationship that he's in as being in a penitentiary and being something that, you know, hey, I'm doing time, because, and it's like, you know, it's a love song or a relationship song and whatnot. And it wasn't necessarily this happy summertime and the living's easy, you know? It had that sublime dark twist to it. And I think that one of Gershwin's thing was they didn't understand that part of it, and they wanted the song to still be recognized as summertime. So Brad, again, not being with us and the song already being recorded, and the Gershwin Estate saying, hey, if you want to put it out, you need to change Doin Time to summertime. So what happened is Miguel went in the studio and actually sings that portion. He says, summertime and the living's easy. Summertime and the living's easy. Miguel is the guy who's back in, and they splice in his vocal of summertime, you know what I mean? So that actually is Miguel. And we believe that was one major request. There might have been a couple other lyrical things, but for the most part, that was the biggie. And you know, we were able to put the song, license it from the Gershwin Estate, give them, I think, 70% of the publishing or something on that one, and got to put it out on Sublime self-titled record. And thank God that, you know, like I said, it was a strange, serendipitous coincidence, but it happened to be the case. And, you know, I would fight till the very end to try to, you know, see that song reach the masses. And thank God that it did. I think it's a really important piece of music in that respect. That's how it happened. You heard it here first.